We come together today giving praise to our Heavenly Father for the many blessings that He gives to us each and every day. And at times, we feel very much alone in the world. Elijah the prophet felt that way. He had just won a great victory over the prophets of Baal at Mount Carmel. The prophets of Baal had created a sacrifice for their god Baal, and they had danced around and fussed around, and nothing had happened all day. And Elijah the prophet would create an altar to the Lord and say, "Lord, consume this offering," and consume it he would. And the people would say, "We follow the Lord our God." And they would then put the prophets of Baal to death. Well, one of the problems with that is that Jezebel the queen and Ahab the king both did not follow the Lord's edicts or commands. Jezebel would often have the 250 prophets of Baal eat dinner at her table. And so, first of all, you wonder how big the table was. And second of all, you wonder how Ahab would explain this to Jezebel. And he would go to her and say, "Jez?" He might have called her Jez, you never know. He would say, "Jezebel, I want you to know you don't have to set places for those 250 prophets of Baal tonight." And she would say, "Well, why not?" She would say, "Well, because," he would say, because Elijah, the sacrifice was consumed, theirs wasn't, and the people put them all to death. And Jezebel would fly into a rage. And anybody will tell you that it's not good to have a raging queen on your hands. And so she would fly into a rage, and she would threaten Elijah. She would say, "As surely as you've done it to those people today, those prophets of Baal today, by tomorrow at this time, you will be in the same condition as they." And Elijah the prophet, who had just seen a great victory of the Lord, Elijah the prophet, who had just seen the Lord's might and power, could have said, "Who do you think you're talking to? You're just a mere queen. I serve the Lord God, the creator of the heaven and earth. Who do you think you are?" But he didn't, because in that moment of time, he felt alone. In that moment of time, he felt cut off from everybody else, and his fear got the best of him. And he would run. He would run into the wilderness, and that's where we pick up our reading today. And after Elijah had run into the wilderness, he would be taken to the mountain of the Lord, and the word of the Lord would come to him there. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" he replied. "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with a sword, and I'm the only one left. And now they're trying to kill me too." The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a still small voice. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. And the voice said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" The Lord God could have said, "Elijah, you've just seen my power displayed. Why in the world did you run away from a mere queen?" But he didn't, because he knew Elijah was already afraid. And so what it would take is a calm, soothing voice, and that calm, soothing voice would ask him the question again, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with a sword, and I'm the only one left, and now they're trying to kill me too." The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came, and go to the desert of Damascus, and when you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu the son of Nimshi king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat from Abel-Meholah to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed to Baal, and all whose mouths have not kissed him." So Elijah would be buoyed up by the Lord, who would show him the big picture. The big picture is something that people in the military often talk about, because you know a small part of the picture. You know you're part of it, but you're a part of a greater whole. And so Elijah was being shown the greater whole. And he would go and do what the Lord God had said. The Lord God would send his Son into the world to take upon his shoulders our sin and to give us life and peace with God the Father that we could not win by force of arms. Life and peace with God the Father that would truly set us free even in the most confining of instances. I had a friend in the Navy by the name of Giles Norrington. Giles Norrington was a very special person. He was a person who, in 1967, I believe, would be flying his last mission from the deck of an aircraft carrier of the United States. He was a pilot, a naval aviator, a very well-trained, very talented soul. But he was at the end of his time in the service, and he was looking forward to a life in the civilian sector. He was looking for, he had a job waiting for him, he had a family waiting for him back home. And he would say as he walked the deck of the ship that last day, I was thinking about my future, about all the great things that would come my way. He would take off from the deck of his aircraft carrier that day and fly over the city of Hanoi when a missile would shoot down his plane. And he would be captured by the North Vietnamese and he would be taken to a prison camp that is known now as the Hanoi Hilton. A prison camp where he was set in solitary confinement for extended periods of time. Giles would tell you that when he left the ship that day, he was very worldly and he was looking toward his future, toward the monetary joy that he would have. And now, captured alone in a cell, all that seemed to be taken from him. And they would tell him time and time again, you're nothing, you're nobody, who do you think you are? And he would say at the beginning, he would do 500 push-ups a day. Well, I wonder if he actually did that many. But he would say 500 push-ups a day, and then he would have all this extra time on his hands, and the tempter would come to him in that time saying, believe them, you're nothing. But in that time of solace, in that time of quiet, that same still small voice that came to Elijah so long ago came to him. That still small voice that would remind him of the hymns that he sang as a youth, of the teachings that he had received. And he would remember. He would remember how great thou art. He would remember hymns like Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. And he would remember Bible verses that he, as a youth, fought at memorizing, but memorize he did. And now they came back like old friends. He remembered. And that memory would lead him to an epiphany in his life, to a time when he would rejoice in the Lord. Because the Lord had come there in the solitary confinement of his life and set him free, freer than he'd ever been before. During the time of his confinement, his wife would divorce him. His children would be estranged from him because he would be there for 5 years of his life. But during the time of his confinement, he found that which was really important for him, and that which is the Lord Jesus Christ and his love and his peace and his victory for each and every one of us. We come as children of the Heavenly Father, and sometimes we need to take away all the sound and listen to that still small voice that says we are heirs of the kingdom of heaven, children of the Heavenly Father, and we rejoice in his glory and his victory each and every day. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the victory you've won for us, for the peace that we have in you. And we pray, O Lord, that you would constantly guide us and lead us in ways of service towards you. Help us to share your love and be your love for those that we serve. Amen.